Inna alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala ashrafil anbiya wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man wala wa ba'd. My dear brothers and sisters, many people have asked me over the years about our whole concept of integrated teaching, integrated education, holistic education and so on, and which is the fundamental methodology of our Standard Bearers Academy teaching standards. And I have explained this in many lectures, especially every LEC we have done this all over the world. But we realized recently that we didn't have all of that together in one place. So we thought let's do that as a separate class. So that's why we decided to have this class, and we hope that this will be of benefit, especially to those who are in the teaching field, people who run schools and people who teach in schools. We hope that this is something that will be beneficial to all of them. Obviously, it is something which we hope will benefit parents as well, because the upbringing of children is really the primary responsibility, is the responsibility of the parents. It's not the responsibility of teachers. Teachers have, if one can say that, a secondary responsibility in that manner of speaking, but end of the day, it's your child, so you are supposed to be more interested in how this child is brought up. So that is why we talk about integrated teaching. I have also talked about this concept in different countries, in South Africa, because I am an advisor to the Association of Muslim Schools there. I've spoken of it twice in 2014 at the International Conference on Faith Education, on Islamic Education in London, and in 2015 in Oxford, where I was the keynote speaker. So both of these places I spoke about that, and that was to an audience which was not only Muslim, it was a faith audience, which means we had the head of Catholic schools of Britain, we had the head of the Department of Education of Britain, we had the we had various the Archbishop of Bedford and of Liverpool, all of these people were there, and alhamdulillah I made a presentation about what is integrated teaching. Not exactly this presentation, but the same concepts in that presentation. And good news side of it, there are two sides to this. The good news side of it was every single person agreed. They all agreed, they all applauded. Downside of it is my question then is, therefore, why is there no change? Why is there no visible change in the world, globally speaking? And Allah knows best. I think it's very important for us, therefore, when you listen to this presentation and so on and so forth, to ask yourself this question and say that, do I really want change? Because change won't happen just by appreciating a lecture or appreciating a thought. Change will happen when you actually make it happen, if you do the work that is required. And that's the reason why it's important to ask yourself that question first. I want to begin with making a very clear statement, and that is that the two capital crimes, and capital crime is a crime for which the sentence is death or should be death, the two capital crimes committed against society today are the commercialization of education and healthcare. Education and healthcare in Muslim societies, all Muslim societies, the system of Khilafah, Islamiyah, which no longer exists, but that the system is the system of a welfare state, which you find in some Western countries, Canada, Australia, UK, where basic education, in some cases it goes up all the way to tertiary education, and healthcare are state subjects. They are run by the government of the state. You don't pay for that service when you avail of that service. In these countries, of course, you pay for it indirectly through through the tax that you pay, your income tax and so on, but you get absolutely world-class service free when you have to avail that service as a patient in a hospital or as a child in a school. And that's why I think that the two major crimes committed against society are these. That's commercialization of education and healthcare. That's what took away the focus from the patient and from the student to making money out of this process. And that is a huge problem with how capitalistic societies are run. And I think that's something that we need to also keep in mind and see how we can change that at a macro level. Of course, question then becomes is, you are not the government, you are a person who is who owns a school or would like to start a school. What is it that you can do? What is it that, how can you make it within quotes free for the student, yet maintain your standards, because nothing comes for free, you need money to for the standard also. This is something which is an ongoing ongoing challenge that we have to all face, and that's the reason why I begin with this slide, which is I know this is a bit of a shock treatment, but as in the words of George Bernard Shaw, he said there's no point in speaking or saying something that does not offend people, because people only change when they are offended. So I hope that the owners and people who run schools are offended when you see this, because then hopefully you will change it. Because this is really the root cause of the problem, that education, healthcare has been commercialized. So the focus is no longer, as I said, the student, the focus is no longer the patient and patient care, it is how to make money out of the system. So what is, I want to begin with what I call the situational diagnosis of what happens today in the name of schooling, in the name of education, but we are focusing here on schools. Now ask yourself, why should you have schools? The reality today is, today if I ask you this question, what do you call a person who has been, who has studied full time for 15 to 17 years? And at the end of that, that person has no life skills and he cannot survive for a week on his own unaided. If I ask you this question, that what do you call a system which produces at the end of 15 or 17 years of full-time education, or what we call education, that person who graduates, that person who comes out of the other end of the machine, has no life skills and cannot take care of himself or herself unaided for a week. What do you call that system? We call that person a high school graduate. Find me one job advertisement with, for which the minimum qualification is high school graduate, and you will see that that job advertisement is probably for a doorman, or it's probably for something like this. There is no job worth doing in our own system where we think that 15 to 17 years of full-time education is sufficient for a person to do that job. Not one single job in any country. Isn't that tragic? Isn't that completely insane? What is it that we are saying about our own system? If I told you that I studied Islam, and I did not study Islam, not about me, but I'm just saying that if I told you that if I studied Islam 15 years or 17 years full-time, what would you call me? You would call me an alim. And then if you tell me, lead two rakat of salah, and I cannot lead two rakat of salah, what will you tell me? So what did you study? What did you do? 15, 17 years, you cannot give a Jummah khutbah, you cannot lead two rakat of salah. What is that system? Absolute trash. This is what you will tell me. And you are absolutely right if you tell me that. Why is it we don't say that to our own children? And the beauty is, you paid for this. It was not 15 or 17 years of free education. You paid and you paid through your nose for this. And I'm not only talking about school fees. I'm talking about school fees. I'm talking about your transportation. I'm talking about your books. I'm talking about clothes. You name it. One of the major budgetary items on any family is the schooling of their children. One of the top priority items with regard to the family's movement around the world is the schooling of children. And at the end of all of that, what have you produced? Somebody who is completely incapable of taking care of himself or herself even for 1 week. If you doubt me, if you want to challenge me, take your high school student, graduate, whoever is in your house, tell him or her to go away and tell them, come back 1 week later. In that 1 week, you must not go to any friend's house, you must not go to any relative's house. You must live on your own for 1 week. I will guarantee you that is the last you will see your child. I'm not asking you to do this, please don't do that. But then ask yourself, what is it you are paying for?
Who is the school for? Let me ask you this question. Who is the school for? Anybody? Schools are for who? Students, right? For children? Then why do you have parent-teacher meetings? Why do you have a parent-teacher association? Where is the child? The school is for the students. So why do you have a parent-teacher meeting? Why are children not involved in decision-making in the school? Which decision in a school, from the time the school opens to how long the school will be, duration of the school, duration of the class, which class will sit where, what will happen, what will not happen, what is allowed, what is not allowed, so on. Which of these decisions is taken with even the mashwara, even the advice of the children? Which decision is left to the children? You can do this, please decide what you want to do, you can do that. Which decision? Which child decides which teacher will teach him or her? Which child decides which is a good teacher, which is a bad teacher? No decision. School is for the children? Seriously? So what choices do children have? So really, who is the school for? And that is why one of my many quotes on education and so on, they are all in my, I've got four books of quotes and you can see them. That's why I say the first casualty of schooling is imagination. And imagination is the first requirement of success in the world, in the future, because the future is something that we do not know what's going to happen. How do you deal with a future that you do not know? By having imagination. The first casualty of education, as we know today, is imagination. The second is independence, because you take it away from the children. For 17 years, they have never made a decision for themselves. And the third one is confidence dies on its own of a broken heart. That is the result of 17 years of school. A child without imagination, a child without the ability to make choices, and a child whose heart is broken and confidence is gone. I was invited to a big madrasa once, and I believe me, this is not about, I'm not bashing madaris here. This is the same situation in schools and madrasas. I was invited to a big madrasa in one of the countries I was visiting, and they said, please speak to the students. These are final year students. They've been in the madrasa for 7-8 years. I said, what would you like to talk to them about? So they said, please talk to them about self-confidence. So I said, did they come here without self-confidence, or is this what you gave them? They said they have no self-confidence. Khud aitmadi pe baat kijiye. To maine kaha ab ye bila aitmad ke aaye the ya yahan pe aane ke baad main aitmad inka le liya gaya. Kya hua? So let me share with you a.
It's, I believe we have a system of education that is modeled on the interests of industrialism and in the image of it. I'll give you a couple of examples. Schools are still pretty much organized on factory lines, so ringing bells, separate facilities, specialized into separate subjects. We still educate children by batches. You know, we put them through the system by age group. Why do we do that? You know, why is there this assumption that the most important thing kids have in common is how old they are? You know, it's like the most important thing about them is their date of manufacture. You know what I mean? Well, I know kids who are much better than other kids at the same age in different disciplines. You know, or at different times of the day. Or better in smaller groups than in large groups. Or sometimes they want to be on their own. If you're interested in the model of learning, you don't start from this production line mentality. It's essentially about conformity, and increasingly it's about that as you look at the growth of standardized testing and standardized curricula. And it's about standardization. I believe we've got to go in the exact opposite direction. That's what I mean about changing the paradigm.
And that is Sir Ken Robinson. You should see his, he's got lots of lectures on schooling. He's got some very good books on schooling. You must read them. Now, why is standardization done? Who does standardization help? Same logic as why standard manufacturing processes are very useful and very productive. They reduce the amount of pressure on the people running the system. I don't have to, if there are 50 people sitting in front of me, if there are 20 students in my class, I don't have to worry about each of them as an individual human being. I can have a standard thing which I apply to all 20 of them. And if you, Mr. Alim Khan, do not fit into that framework, that is your problem. So I will try to chop you and change you and somehow stick you into that hole. And if you can't stick into the hole, then I go to your parents and say, your son Alim Khan is useless and he cannot study, take him out of the school. That is what happens in our schools. And I am submitting to you that Alim Khan is an individual. Alim Khan has dignity. Alim Khan has the right to be treated as an individual human being with his needs and with his strengths and with his weaknesses, because he comes to me as a student. Let me ask you this question. What do you call this place? Authoritarian structure. Orders are given, you follow. Bell rings. A class is 45 minutes. We do not trust that you have the sense to be able to stop the class at 45 minutes. We do not trust you, teacher. We do not trust you, students. Even though you have watches and so on, we think you are blind and stupid. So we have to ring a bell to know, to let you know that the class is over. You have gone off for an interval to play, and we do not trust you, Mr. and Mrs. and Miss Student, that you have enough intelligence to come back to class. Therefore, we have to ring a bell to say that the play time is over. You want to play now? Sorry. Play time is at 11:15. At 11:15, you may not want to play. I don't care. That is play time. If you don't want to play at 11:15, you don't get to play. I am hungry now. Can I eat? No, you cannot eat. Lunchtime is 1 o'clock. But at 1 o'clock, I'm not hungry. That's not my problem. That's your problem. If you don't want to eat at 1 o'clock, you can go hungry for the rest of the day, because the next lunchtime will come tomorrow at 1 o'clock. So you can go home and eat, but you cannot eat now. Why? Because this is class. How does eating something in class interfere with my learning? I'm not interested in your questions. Shut up. Authoritarian system. What do you call a place where once you get inside, the gate shuts and you cannot get out until the gate opens, and the gate will open by the authority of the person who runs the place, not by you? What do you call such a place? What do you call a place where there is a dress code? You can't wear whatever you like. What is a place? What do you call a place where silence and order are supremely important? That is why even the seating is designed in such a way that there is impossibility of interaction between students. What is the place where you call where there is reward and punishment, and punishment is generally more than the reward? How many times in a school do you give rewards? Once in a term, once in a year, twice in a year, this day, that day, annual day, falana day, bhukana day? How many times do you give punishment? Every day. What do you call a system where you have to walk in lines? What do you call a system where if you want to go to the toilet, you cannot go when you feel like going? You have to ask. You have to sit in the class and you have to do this. At least in India, this is what we do. This means what? Small job. This means big job. And then if the person comes back late, and you know why you have to say this and this? Because the teacher is watching, how long do you take? What do you call a system where your freedom is completely abridged? You don't have freedom. You can't talk to, you can't, in class you cannot talk to your neighbor. You can't talk to your friend in class. In an examination, we'll come to examination, I treat that as a separate subject. Even you come to, in an examination, what do you call those who collaborate and help each other? Cheating, you punish them, you rusticate them, you throw them out of the class. And the same person does exactly the same behavior when he goes into a workplace. What do? You say, "Clap, mashallah, we're great, great teamwork. Must help each other." Oh, really? You just taught me for 17 years that helping each other was a crime. Now you want me to help each other? What do you call a place where the people in there have no input in decision making? Prison? Yes or no? Do all of these things apply to prisons? Wrong answer. That's a school. That is the vast majority, if not all, the schools at least that I know, globally.
So the problem with schools today is that schools are run for profit. Teachers teach because it is their job. Parents want to outsource parenting. Primary goal of most parents is get rid of the children for 8 hours a day or 10 hours a day. As far as I am concerned, rest of it doesn't matter. As long as they are out of my house, out of them, out of my hair for 8 to 10 hours, I am happy. So outsource parenting, and students are prisoners. So what must change? All of these must change. What is the problem with teaching discrete subjects without any relation to each other? Physics is taught in the hour of physics, physics period. Next period is chemistry. Does the chemistry period have any relation with the physics period which I just attended 1 hour ago? No. Different subject. Is physics and chemistry, are they actually related? You bet your life they are related. Next topic, history. Next subject, geography. Are history and geography actually related? Khyber Pass in the Himalayas is geography. The Mughals came through that is history. If there was no Khyber Pass, there would be no Mughals. Then you might say, well, that might be a great thing, but I wouldn't be sitting here either. Where have you seen this in teaching? Why have you not seen it in teaching? Two, pressure on memorizing, not on understanding. When was the first battle of Panipat fought? Who cares? Who cares? How does it matter? What matters is why was this battle fought? What did we learn from this battle which was fought? Where is that question in a history paper? Tell me. Memorization. Questioning is discouraged. A student asks a question once or twice, he is tolerated. If the person asks a question too many times, he is a troublemaker. He always asks questions. Makes noise in the class, disturbs my class. Because I have to finish my portion. Job of the teacher, I have to finish so many pages. And these people asking questions, they are a problem for me. Dissent. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Same thing applies across the board. We teach tafsir of Quran. Next session, hadith. Is there a relation between hadith and tafsir? No. Next session, fiqh. In the fiqh, do you address the masail which were read that day in the tafsir class and in the hadith class? No. Discrete subjects. Is fiqh related to hadith and tafsir? Of course. Where did fiqh come from? From Quran and Sunnah. We do not integrate the subjects. Same, exactly the same things, whether it is secular schools or madaris. Dissent. Find me somebody who can sit in a madrasa or sit in a school and disagree with the teacher. Then, practical application of knowledge is ignored. If a student asks a question and says, you are teaching me Archimedes' principle. So, where can I apply this? I can probably guarantee you that no student will ask this question and no teacher will answer this question. The person says, you are teaching me algebra. A equals B, B equals C, therefore A equals C. What is the application? Why should I learn this? Why? A equals B and B equals C, therefore A equals C, according to me, is a great principle in human interrelations, which I have used many times in negotiations. Learned it in the algebra class, but I had to do all the math for that to join it myself. My teachers didn't teach me. And examinations, they measure only one thing. Random recall within a specific time frame. That's it. Examinations do not measure knowledge. They do not measure understanding. They do not measure practical application. They measure only one thing. Random recall within a specific time frame. Tell you, just ask this question, and we have all been through this. Have you not had one of your children, or did this not happen to you, that 5 minutes after you finished that examination, you remembered the right answer? But you failed. Why did you fail? Because you could not remember it at before 9:15. So do you know or you don't know? If you know, then why did you fail? Because it's a nonsensical system. If they were measuring knowledge, they would say no problem. It's not a life-threatening thing. If I remember something 5 minutes later, so what? Big deal. But it's an insane system. So you say, no, you fit. And your failing now affects the rest of your career. You can't get into college. You can't do this. It's not a simple. That failure is not a simple matter. That failure actually affects your life negatively. And we quietly go home and tamely and miserably, kya karte? Fail hoga bacha. Bacha nahi fail hoga, tumhara pura system fail hoga. Bacha kaisa fail hota? And all of this is based on compulsion. So no joy, no discovery, no energy, no enthusiasm. Everyone is doing it because they're compelled to do it. Class size and composition. You saw what Ken Robinson says, and I say the same thing. Classes are made up by date of manufacture. All 5 years old, 5 year olds in one class, 6 years, 7 years, 8 years. Why? This is completely contrary to human psychology. It is completely contrary to how people learn. Let me ask you this question. Those of you who have several children, may Allah give you more. Do you tell your 10 year old child, do not talk to the 5 year old sister. Don't go near that sister. Don't talk to the sister. Don't do it. Or do you do the opposite? Do you tell the older children, look after your younger brothers and sisters? Teach them, be nice to them. Which one do you do? So how come when you come to school now, all 5 years old in one box, 6 years of one, 7 year one, 8 year one, 9 year one, why? We don't even ask this question. Somebody should ask this question. Why do you segregate classes based on age? What does age have to do with anything? Human beings learn in groups. In Africa, there is a wonderful saying, they say it takes a whole village to bring up a child. People learn from those who are older than them. Children learn from other friends who are older than them. So our class formation system is against and contrary to the way human beings function. Size of class is maximized to maximize income per student. Teacher salary, 10,000. If I have 15 students in the class, 10,000 divided by 15. If I have 50 students in the class, same 10,000 divided by 50. So my profit per student is more. Therefore, this is how we organize our schools. Right? Seating, as I mentioned, classroom seating is the finest way to ensure that you will never get any interaction between students. Because there is nothing inspiring about looking at the back of somebody's head. So one-way communication, teacher talks, students listen, take notes, bell rings, go home. Seating is actually maximized to minimize the benefit of learning in groups. Pressure on silence. Pin drop silence. Have you heard this statement? Yeah. We had a teacher in school, wonderful man. We all loved him very much. But one of his things, he used to pull out his belt and he would hold it like this and he would say, I will powder you. Yeah. I will powder you. Ahmed is laughing because he knows who the man is. He says, I'll powder you. Yeah, he didn't powder and he was a nice man. But this one, if you make a noise, no noise, pin drop. What is the meaning of pin drop silence? It means that if a pin drops, you should be able to hear it. That is the level of silence that they want in class. Absolutely detrimental to learning. Wherever I have taught, I measure my success from the amount of noise in the class. More noise means more success. Because they are interacting, they are doing things, they are asking questions. As far as I am concerned, as long as nobody is physically assaulting me, I don't care. I haven't done it yet. Obedience, conformity, question and disagreement. No, sorry. Final question I want to ask you. How do you measure teacher effectiveness? Do you measure teacher effectiveness at all in the first place? In schools? And if you do measure teacher effectiveness, how? I know only one way of measuring the effectiveness of any service provider. And what is that? Customer feedback. There's no other way. Any service provider, the only logical way of measuring the quality of any service is ask the customers. Who are the customers in a school? Students.
Who must do the appraisal of a teacher? Students. Does it happen? Ask why not? Because the school is not for the students. If the school was for the students, you would do that. And you would say to the teacher, I'm sorry, you are getting a negative appraisal from the students. Their students are saying they are not learning anything and this. Goodbye. This must happen. And that's why my question is, why else would global leaders make the same mistakes since the Roman empires for the last 2000 years, except that they are trained in a flawed system? Why are there economic ups and downs? Why do you get one bad leader after another bad leader, again and again and again? Believe me, they all went to school. They all went to university. In our case, in this country, some of them did not go to university. Maybe they didn't. The system is flawed. Let me ask you a question. Who are the heroes in our system? Alexander the Great. Why? Why is he great? Because he left Macedonia, where he was living peacefully, and he decided to conquer the world. What does it mean? It means he decided to invade other countries, rape and loot and plunder and annex other people's properties. So he is great. Now you are glorifying a mass murderer. You are glorifying a brigand and a highway robber. You are glorifying the fact that he perfected the art of mass killing because of his military tactics and how he used, or Genghis Khan, how he used the curved, double curved bow and so on and so forth. And then you say, how is it we don't have peace in the world? Insane, right? Final question. How is it that we think we know all about this world? Today we pride ourselves and say that we are the most knowledgeable generation of all time, which I think is a load of, you know what, processed grass. But people believe this, right? So you say, well, if you are so knowledgeable, how come you are destroying the world? What's the biggest global threat today? Not Donald Trump. Global warming, which Donald Trump is one of the many people he disagrees. He says it's not happening, right? Because he's sitting in the Oval Office, which is air conditioned. How is it possible? If we are really so knowledgeable about this world, how is it that we are allowing this world to be destroyed? We got somewhere else to go? Elon Musk says we must establish colonies on Mars. So maybe that's what they are planning to do. Huh? Destroy one planet and then go to another planet and then destroy that also. La hawla quwwata illa billah. So let me ask you this question. I think enough bad news. Let's look at some positive aspects now. What if schooling created a lifelong love for learning? Do you think that's a good thing? Worth doing? What if schooling inculcated ethics, morals and values? Lack of ethics, morals and values is a global phenomenon today. We are living in a world where ethics, morals and values have zero importance, irrespective of culture, religion. Nobody's got it. Muslims don't have it. Christians don't have it. Nobody's got it. And that's why and that's the reason why we should try to be ethical and moral, because one of the things that I'm not saying do it for that reason, but one of the things that you will stand out in that situation. Because there are so few people doing that, almost nobody doing that. What if schooling taught brotherhood, and it taught teamwork, and it taught leadership? What if schooling produced strong, compassionate, courageous citizens of the world? Yeah, what if this, could we do this? Now I guarantee you every single one of these things is possible, but only for those who are willing to try. Who seriously want it. Not just lip service. So what must be done? Number one, in 2014 when I was speaking at the International Conference on
International Islamic Conference on Faith Education in London. It was in the Queen Elizabeth Conference Center, which is directly across the street from Westminster Abbey. So I said there, I said, what must be done to this current education system? I said, you can do one of two things. I said, you can take it across the street here to Westminster Abbey and give it a good Christian funeral, or you can go down the road to St. James Park, to the Islamic center there, to the masjid, and give it a good Muslim funeral. That's what you need to do. Bury it. Because the system as it is completely toxic. So we have to start afresh, completely new. And for that, I submit to you that teachers must change first. And how must they change? Number one is, you must love your children enough to cry for them in the night before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As a teacher, if you are not standing in tahajjud and praying for your students and crying before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their success, then you are not worthy to be called a teacher. Anyone who is working a job for a salary will never do that, not in a million years. Number two is, you must become their role models. And you must be their point of reference even after you are dead and gone. Whenever they are faced with a moral dilemma, they must think of you and as a teacher and say, what would my teacher have done in this situation? I am about to do this. Can I go and tell my teacher about this? I have this question in my mind, should I take this decision or not? Should I talk to such a person or should I do this or not? Is it something that I feel comfortable asking my teacher, or would I be ashamed to talk to my teacher about this? And learning, please note, I'm not saying teaching, learning must be visibly your first priority. You want students to love learning, you have to love learning. To light a single lighted lamp can light a million others, but a dead lamp can't light anything. So it's not enough to be a lamp, it must be a lighted lamp. And that's why I say, collect dots or connect dots. This is the difference between information and knowledge, between mugging and understanding, between success and failure. Today in our puerile education system, we collect dots, we don't connect them. So they make no sense, even if they are the right dots. Now there are four things that schooling must achieve. Number one, awaken the conscience. Number two, create excitement for learning. Number three, make sense in terms of application. What I am studying, I must be able to apply. Not in some distant future. No, now. I should be able to apply what I am learning right now. And the fourth one is what I call the social skills basket. I must be able to function productively and positively in the society that I live in. If these four things are not being achieved, then schooling is a waste. What is happening in that school is a waste of time. And when you are saying achieved, I am not saying that after looking at these four things, then you say, no, you think in my school it is achieved. No, my question to you as a school person is, do you have a similar chart in your school that your school is designed to fulfill? If this is the first time you saw this, then your school is already not achieving what it should be achieving. I submit to you that the single most powerful change to transform the world is for us to move from the world is responsible for me to I am responsible for the world. I believe in this, I hold myself responsible for this, and that is why I am teaching this class, even though, as you know, I have no school that I benefit from, I have no children to send to that school, I don't get any salary from any school. Why am I doing this?
because it is our individual responsibility. What happens to the world is my responsibility, is your responsibility. And that's why Rasulullah said, Ummat Pana, the feeling of being part of the Ummah is what? He said, is to feel that you are responsible for the entire Ummah. And the entire Ummah must feel that they are responsible for each individual person. We must begin with the foundation of values. Why values? Because values drive behavior and behavior drives results. And the important thing to understand about values is, values must be inculcated. They cannot be legislated. You cannot tell somebody, don't tell lies. You have to show what the meaning of standing for truth is. The child will learn don't tell lies when they see you taking the rap for making a mistake and owning up. Then they know the meaning of don't tell lies. Everybody says don't tell lies. And then what does the child see? What does the child see at home? What does the child see in school? The parents tell children don't tell lies. Then the child goes late to school because there is you parent were supposed to drop the child to school, you did not do that. So what do you do? Or you want the child to bunk one day of class because you have taken them for a holiday. So what do? You write a false letter saying the child was sick. You get a false medical certificate. The child knows it is a lie. You give it to the child and say, give it to the teacher. The teacher accepts it. Now you tell the child, don't tell lies. What is the child actually learning? That there are times to tell lies. Phone rings. Child picks up the phone. Yeah, nowadays we have mobile phones and so on. So we have, you get caller ID and whatnot. I'm just saying, I'm sure many of you have seen this thing. Landline rings, you don't know who the caller is. Child picks up the phone and from the answering, the child, from hearing the child answer the phone, you realize it's someone you don't want to talk to. So you say, I'm not here. So he says, daddy says he's not here. And you tell children, don't tell lies. And if he tells a lie, bah! So if you look at the foundation of values, what is the first thing that we need to do? Accountability to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why values? Because one day we will face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalal. You can fool all the world, no problem. You can't fool Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So six important things. First one, integrity, truthfulness, compassion, courage, citizenship, and teamwork. To teach all of this, that's the reason why the number one requirement for a school is not infrastructure, it's not money, it's not resources, it's not even students, it is the right teachers. Schools are made or broken, make or break by teachers and teachers only. All the rest are aids for teachers to teach. I am all in favor of great infrastructure, I am all in favor of using of technology and so on and so forth, all of which we must do. But a lousy teacher cannot make, technology cannot make a lousy teacher great. Simple as that. So what must change? Everything must change. As I told, current system in the ground, new system must come out from the ground. Six things that need to change. Number one is core purpose. Why are you running the school itself? Number two, autonomy of students. Number three, class size and composition. Number four, curriculum and syllabus. Number five, teaching methodology. Number six, the examination system. But for all of this to happen, the number one thing that must change is mindset. We need to believe that this is required. Otherwise, nothing will happen. So let's quickly go through each of these. Core purpose. Do you have a core purpose statement in your school? What are you trying to create in your school? And if you tell me, yes, you have a core purpose statement, then I will take your statement. And you know what I will do? I will do what I do when I go to do a quality audit in a business, in a global business. I go to the doorman and I ask the doorman, what is the vision of your company? I go to the sales clerk, lowest form of life, and I ask them, what is the vision of your company? I don't go to the CEO. I don't go to the head of human resources. I don't go to the vice president, manufacturer or marketing. I go to the least, within quotes, person in the system and ask them, what is the core purpose? And if that person cannot tell me what is written on your statement here, this statement is trash in the garbage. So, if you are running a school, ask yourself, what is the purpose? Why are we running the school? And if you thought of it at that point in time, it means that you did not have a purpose till then. And then go and talk to your doorman and to your lowest, within quotes, form of life. See what they say. Number two question is, which I will ask you is, now you have a co-purpose statement. How do you arrive at this statement? How did you get to the statement? How should you get to the statement? A core purpose statement comes from what's in the hearts of all the people who are involved with that system. It is evolved from there. It is not imposed from somewhere. I have gone to schools, and I won't name them, I don't want to shame anybody, but I have gone to schools and madrasas where people have taken bits and pieces of my quotes from my presentations. For example, one of my most famous ones is a mufassir who is a administrator and a muhaddis who is a surgeon and so on. You know that statement of mine. I have seen this on the wall of one of the madaris. I don't care. It's fine. I give away all of this stuff free of cost. It's all public information. So and to me, imitation and plagiarism is the most sincere form of praise. But my point is, what is the good of that? You simply steal some words from somewhere and you stick it on a wall and you think your job is done. Believe me, you can steal what you want, nothing will change. Because the change has to come from inside here. Ask yourself, what is your core purpose? Why are you running that school? Number two is, what differentiates you in the market? You are doing that, so are 320 other people. So what makes you special? Until you define the final product of your school in terms of what that person will be trained for and capable of doing, nothing will change. So ask yourself this question: what will be lost if your school does not exist? What is the answer for most schools? Nothing will be lost. If your school shuts down, they go to some other school. Class. So why are you running the school? Because I'm making money. Simple as that. Second thing that must change is the autonomy of students. If the school is for children, they must decide what happens there. Now, some of you who don't know my history and read my book, it's called It's My Life. A lot of my case studies are written in that book. Those of you who don't know me and who don't know my history might say, well, you know, it's easy for you to sit and say all of this, but how can it be done? I tell you, I did that in a school in Kerala on the border of Tamil Nadu and Kerala in Kanyakumari district, in a place called Thiruvattar. For 3 years, I ran that school as the correspondent, which means I was above the principal. I was the administrator of the school. And that was my side job, because my actual job was doing something else, but this was part of the job. And we completely turned around that school it was what is called a partially aided school. So partially aided means that some of the salaries of the teachers, part of the salary bill was paid for by the government and the rest of it was paid for by the trust which ran the school. And when I took over that school, it was in a situation where that school was losing classes, losing teachers, losing salaries because nobody wanted to come to that school. That entire area is very poor. Almost 100% of the students in that school were Dalits, came from very poor backgrounds. Alcoholism, wife beating, drugs, all of this was rampant in that entire society. So the children came from homes which were, they've been traumatic experiences were, part of their life. Father comes home drunk, beats up the mother in front of the children. All of this was standard behavior. And obviously the children came to the school and there was no way to take care of any of that. And the school was chaos.
First day I went to the school, it was like going to a garbage heap. It had 2 acres of land, which was a pretty good bit of land for that school. The whole place was like 2 acres of garbage. There were paper and plastic everywhere and all kinds of graffiti on the walls. First thing I suggested to the teachers, I had a class, a teacher's meeting. 1200 students, 75 teachers. I'm not talking about a small school. So I called a meeting of the teachers and I said, I am proposing the following. And I said, first thing is we will establish a students' council. I tell you, I had no camera. I should have had a camera at that time to take the picture on the faces. The teachers look like this man is mad. I mean, what kind of thing is this? Where did he come from? Which planet? Students' council. They said, what is that? I said, that is a council which will be formed of students. Students will elect their own representatives to the council. And this council will decide on whatever happens in school. Somebody objected. I said, you have got a choice. You want to work with me or you want to get out, get out. Simple. Very great reluctance. Now, you might think that when I went to the students with that, they were delighted. They were not delighted. The students also looked at me like I'm crazy. Because no one treated them with respect until that time. So, they said, what is this? Student council, what is that? So, I sat with them. I said, look, this is what we want. This is what we want to do with the school and we want you guys to participate in this. So, elect your representatives. So, they got into the act. And I said, I will sit in the council meeting. So, in the council meeting, the teachers are not going to intimidate the students. No, no, no. You will listen to them. So, they said, what can they decide? I said, anything. They will decide on which are the holidays. They will decide on what time the school will begin. They will decide on how long, when will it end. They will decide on periods. They will decide on intervals. They will decide on what time lunch break, what time tea break, what time this break, that break. Anything they want, the students will decide and it will be implemented. What do you think happened? Do you think we suddenly had every day is a holiday? We are playing all the time. Teaching time goes down from 8 hours to 1 hour. Do you think this happened? Nothing changed. Except that now they did that voluntarily because they came to those numbers themselves. They said, we want a longer break. I said, no problem, take it. I said, but I've got an issue. What's the issue? This portion has to be completed. We've got to finish this. So you tell me how to do that. They said, then what we'll do is we'll take a longer break and then we'll have the end of the school extended a little bit. I said, that's fine, but the teachers have to go home. They got a particular bus they have to catch and so on and so forth. So what about that? Put it back to them. With some minor changes which we were happy to make. But everything was voluntary, they did themselves. Then I called them and I said, look, see this whole school, garbage. You know, I said, no problem. I said, what I'm going to do is, I'm not telling you clean the garbage. All I'm saying is, what I will do is, I did a drawing of the school, map of the school. And I said, I divided up the map into the number of classes. So I said, this piece belongs to this class, this piece belongs to this class, this piece belongs to this class. And every 3 months, I'm going to run a competition of the most beautiful plot in the school and I will give prizes. That school changed overnight. Overnight, this is in Kerala. You put a walking stick, it will grow. You know, beautiful soil and weather and so on. Overnight, that entire garbage got cleaned, walls got painted. They came to me and they said, can you give us some lime and some brushes? I said, for what is it? We want to paint all this. I said, why you wrote all that? No, we are ashamed, we don't want to write all this. They didn't come to me. The students didn't come to me and say, find somebody and paint the wall. They said, no, give us the lime and stuff, we will do it. They brought plants from their homes. They came to me, they said, can I plant? I said, don't ask me questions, then. Dumb questions. I gave you the plot of land, belongs to you. Do what you want. Huh? Water leaking from a tank, the student rep comes to me and says, sir, please, can we have a plumber? I don't know how to root myself. Can I have a plumber? Why? The water is leaking there. That water was leaking for the last 10 years. Half the time the water was leaking because they didn't turn the taps off. Now they come to me and say, can you find a plumber, please? We want to fix this. Same school. Nothing changed. I didn't fire one single teacher. Nothing. I said, no corporal punishment, no teacher will touch a student. I made very clear. I said, if you beat the student, I will beat you. We'll go to the police, no problem. If you touch a student, I will touch you. Simple as that. They said, oh, there will be no discipline, blah, blah. I said, very good, fantastic. Discipline is the lousiest thing to do. Even though I'm going to tell you, teach discipline, but not like this, not military discipline. Must come from inside. Dignity is the principal thing. And dignity comes from choice. Treat them like human beings. And finally, we said, teachers are accountable to the students. They are your customers, they will decide. Whether you have a job tomorrow or not, they will decide. And if you get a good feedback from the children, we give you bonuses. Both sides. We are not just punishing you. We'll give you a bonus. We'll give you your 1 month salary. We'll give you 10 month salaries. Whatever. We'll give you the bonus. Students will decide. Third thing that must change is class size and composition. Not more than 15 students per class. Multiple ages, not by date of manufacture. And third one is multiple teachers in the class. A class teacher and subject teachers. So each class will have maybe two teachers, maybe three teachers, depending on what's being taught. And I'll come to the project teaching in a minute, so you will see how this will make sense. But that must happen, supported by state-of-the-art technology. And today it has become not just cheap, it has become free. With my laptop and with the high-speed internet that we have, and this is now standard across the world practically, except for South Africa, which has the lousiest internet in the world. But otherwise, every place in the world, we've got 4G and we've got, you know, very decent internet speeds. With a laptop and with that internet speed, I can bring a classroom from China into this class. I can show you, for example, if I'm teaching how rain falls, I can show you a fantastic National Geographic or Discovery video on the entire process of precipitation, which makes it real for you. Yeah. And so on and so on. And all of it is free. I pay nothing for it. I'm already paying for my internet connection. I already have a laptop. Nothing. You need nothing. So, state-of-the-art technology does not mean that you have to now pump in money into your school. Nothing, nothing, nothing. Absolutely nothing. I can get you lectures, for example, today, and this is the beauty of really great institutions. MIT, for example, has got everything open source. Everything, the entire library of MIT is available for anyone who wants to study. So I can get you, for example, I can get the greatest teacher of physics, Kurt Lewin, in from MIT. I can show you live his lectures in physics. I'm teaching you, for example, motion, and I can show you a video of that man teaching the issue of how a pendulum moves. And you can see that video live. I can show it to your children. So they are learning from that great teacher of physics in America. They are sitting and learning that here, free. Is this happening in your schools? If it's not happening, ask why. Because you run the schools to make money and your teachers teach for their salary. That's why. All this stuff is available free of cost. Then, curriculum and syllabus. Refer to your core purpose. Curriculum must fulfill the core purpose. Design the curriculum which can deliver what your core purpose is supposed to deliver. A curriculum that does not deliver that is worthless. Now you might say, well, you know, I am bound by the state curriculum and so on and so forth. No, you are not bound by the state curriculum. The state curriculum, you have to fulfill certain requirements of that. But you can design your own curriculum which fulfills those requirements and more, so that your children, when they go for a state examination, even though that is a nonsensical thing, doesn't matter, they will still pass very well. Plus, they will have real knowledge when they come out of the school. State curricula do not have to restrict you to teaching only that. Focus on understanding and application, not on mindless memorizing and regurgitation. And understand that a curriculum and syllabus must create a lifelong love for learning. Let me ask you this question. Many of you here have children who have graduated from school. What did your son or daughter do with their textbooks
the day after they passed school. If they were Indians, they probably sold them for in a second-hand bookshop, because they don't. We don't throw stuff. We make some money. We make some money out of it. Otherwise, junk. So for 15 years, you teach them physics and chemistry and maths and this and that, and the value they have for that is they take the textbook and junk it. What does it tell you? What should it tell you? And that's why I say stop teaching and start discovering. I'm going to send out some reading material with this, where there's one of the articles of mine which says, "Oh teacher, stop teaching." So please read that when the material comes. The next thing which must change is teaching methodology. Integrate knowledge, not discrete subjects, and I'm going to come to that and explain that to you in detail in a few minutes. Focus on application and practical experience, not just on mugging up discrete bits of information. And open doors to further inquiry. Support questioning, support dissent, support critical analysis. And understand very clearly that children listen with their eyes. Everybody listens with their eyes, even adults. People don't care what you say until they see what you do. You cannot tell children to pray Salatul Fajr in the masjid if you are not praying Salatul Fajr in the masjid. That's simple as that. You can't tell children not to tell lies if you are telling lies. So teach by demonstration, because that's the only way to teach. The examination system. Regurgitating undigested food is called vomit. Regurgitating undigested information is called passing examinations. What's an exam? Is a name given to a test, to test to see if you can regurgitate, vomit out unprocessed information within a specific time frame. You need to abolish this system. Shut it down. So you might say, well, you know, do we not examine children at all? Of course you examine them. But you don't examine them in this way. You know why this system is done? Because it is easiest for you to do. Not for the children. Simplest thing for me is to simply write a bunch of questions. As long as they are regurgitating the answers, fine, you passed. What does it mean? It means nothing. I don't care. The child has no voice. You must examine them for what? Test understanding, test application, test change values, test for broadened horizons, not just memory. Not just memory. Your student is a human being, he's not a silicon chip. You're not seeing how much data can I get into this. And the final thing is teachers. Think agriculture. Now if you are a farmer and you want a good crop, what must you do? Three things are required. Number one is prepare the soil. You can have the best seed in the world, but you go and put it into soil which is not prepared, which is stony and rocky and it's full of thorns and all kinds of bad stuff, that crop will fail. So the first thing to do is prepare the soil. Number two is plant the best seed. You can prepare the soil beautifully, but you've got substandard seed, you still will not get a good crop. And the third one is water it. You have the best soil in the world, best prepared, best seeds planted, no watering, they will not germinate, or if they germinate, they will dry up and die, crop will fail. Three things. That's why I say teachers must become farmers. What is preparation of the ground? Prepare the students to receive the learning. Prepare them to receive the learning. And then give them the best information and knowledge. Help them connect the dots, not just collect dots. And then the watering is the standing in the night before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and crying for the understanding of the students. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent as a teacher and with the same framework. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the same framework. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, tell them what the revelation is. Recite for them the book. Recite the ayah. And then, يُزَكِّهِمْ, prepare them, purify them to receive what you told them. And then teach them, يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ. You already told them, what is there to teach? There is to teach. And then, wal hikmah, demonstrate how it is to be done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, aqimus salah. Ayat has come, aqimus salah. What must I do, ya Rasulullah? Go make wudu, go make ghusl. Prepare yourself for salah and come. And then what must I do? Did Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam simply say, aqimus salah, establish salah? No, it has to be taught. How is it to be done? I am ready to establish salah. What does it mean? How am I to teach it? How am I to do it? He taught the method. Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli, which is the last part, which is the hikmah. Do as you see me do. Pray as you see me pray. Exactly the same framework for the physics teacher, for the chemistry teacher, for the mathematics teacher, for the history teacher, for the hadith teacher, for the tafsir teacher, for the fiqh teacher. Same methodology, which is the methodology of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prepare the soil, plant the best seed, and then cry in the night before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unless a teacher can cry for his or her students, they will not be the students. They cannot succeed. And that's why teachers themselves must be inspired to be inspirational. You cannot inspire anyone unless you are inspired yourself. So we come to the last section of this, which is the Quranic methodology of teaching. And at this point, let's quickly take a break and have some tea and come back in 15 minutes exactly, and then we will finish the rest of the class. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil karim wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in bi rahmatika wa rahmatika.